Let's go into the session as such. We are actually looking into the basics of oxygen therapy. And I am not going to speak anything new, only the basics which you are very familiar, but I want to stress few points which will help you in your oxygen management. Now, this session will be targeting at the understanding of the very basic physiological principles of oxygen therapy and understanding of the systems you have in your hospitals and their use, and the interfaces we use for delivering oxygen, their indications and considerations, and how do we monitor the adequacy of patient oxygenation and the effectiveness of our oxygen therapy. And we'll discuss a few points regarding considerations in COPD patients. Now, coming to the basics of respiration, which you are learning from school itself, like the respiration basically has two parts, as you very much know. The respiration has two parts. There is an external respiration as well as an internal respiration. Why I am going into this basics is, if you know these things clearly, then you will be able to manage a patient with hypoxia. Now, like any patient who is having an external respiration, means it is an exchange of gases between the atmosphere and the lungs. And the internal respiration is exchange of gas from the blood to the tissues. Now, the external respiration, I will come in detail about these two things. Like I just shown in this slide, like external respiration is between the environment and the lungs. This is the first exchange of gas. And this is carried through the blood. And the major part of respiration happens in the cells. This is the internal respiration. Here, the cells get oxygen from the blood vessel and the activity goes on in the cells at the tissue level. As I said earlier, the external respiration is movement of oxygen from the atmosphere to the lungs. And in the lungs, you can see the alveoli, which is the minutest division of the lung, which is covered by a capillary network. Here, what happens is the alveoli is a one-celled, covered by an one-celled member, it is a one-celled thin coating, and the capillary is also one-celled. There is only one cell in the coating of the alveoli and one cell in the coating of the capillary. And there is an alveolar capillary membrane in between these two. So when the gas exchange happens at the lung level, the exchange of gases actually is from the alveoli through the alveolar capillary membrane to the capillary. So if there is any problem in any of these places, we'll have a problem. That's why I am trying to highlight this slide. Now, what are the actual processes that happen in respiration? First, I said external respiration happens, and this is a movement of oxygen from atmospheric air to the lungs. Now, the exchange of gases in the lungs happens between the alveolar air and the blood in the lung capillaries. Once the blood is filled with this oxygen, the blood will immediately carry this oxygen to other parts of the body. This is the blood gas transport. And next is at the tissue level. Here, there is again another exchange of gases in the tissues between the blood in the capillaries to the tissues. And once the oxygen enters the cell, now biological oxidation happens and there is release of energy. This is the internal respiration. So when we speak about oxygen transport, we'll be going through these steps. Again, elaborating on this, from external to internal respiration, this is the oxygen exchange process. What happens? Like in the atmospheric air, we have oxygen and other gases. Majority of gas is nitrogen, which is about 79%, and around 21% or between 20 and 21% is oxygen. So atmospheric air with an atmospheric pressure of 760 millimeters of mercury will have a 21% oxygen, whereby like out of this 760, if you take 21%, the PO2 of the inspired air will come to 160 millimeters of mercury. That is what we are going to inspire from the atmosphere. And carbon dioxide in the inspired air is only 0.3. Now we pass to the lung. In the lung, out of this partial pressure of oxygen 160, what we are inhaling, the alveoli, at the alveolar level, the partial pressure of oxygen comes down to 104 millimeters of mercury. We'll go into the reasons why this 160 falls to 104 by the time it reaches the alveoli. In the alveoli, the gas exchange occurs across the alveoli, alveolar membrane, and into the blood through the capillary. And now we are, with the oxygen, we are also traveling in the arterial side. And now we have a partial pressure of oxygen of 104. So now we are in the artery with a partial pressure of oxygen around 104 millimeters of mercury. We have started from the atmosphere from 160 millimeters of mercury. We have reached the alveolus, the partial pressure of oxygen has dropped to 104 millimeters of mercury. And then in the arterial side, again, a small drop will also happen because there is some small venous blood joining the artery, like the bronchial circulation, coronary venous return. All this might drop the partial pressure of oxygen again from 104 to a little lower. That will come to around 95. So now inhaling an oxygen with a partial pressure of 160, we are on the arterial side, say aorta, with a partial pressure of oxygen of 95 millimeters of mercury. This is for a normal person with a normal gas exchange. And now we are traveling again through the artery from the aorta down to the tissues. At the tissue level, our plan was to release the oxygen to the tissues for the tissue metabolism. Now the partial pressure of oxygen falls down further. I will elaborate into this point, like how much oxygen will fall down after the oxygen release at the tissue level. Now, this cartoon says, like the lung said, I have oxygen with me. I will share with everybody in the body. And that is how the blood takes the oxygen from the lungs to every part of the body. Now, the question is, like, why do we need oxygen at all? Like, we are breathing oxygen unknowingly, but why do we need oxygen? Now, for any metabolism to happen in the body, any activity to happen in the body, we need oxygen. And oxygen is like money. In the tissue level, for each cell to function properly, it has to have an energy, high energy levels. It's like we are going to shopping with some money. If we have money, we can spend, we can do a lot of activities. If we don't have money, we'll finish off with little activities and come back unhappy. Now, the same thing is the situation at the tissue level. Consider a cell, any cell in the body. If you have oxygen, the one glucose molecule in the presence of oxygen in the cell at the mitochondrial level can release 38 ATP. This is considered to be the energy of the cell. 38 ATP molecules, ATP can be released from one glucose molecule at the tissue level if there is oxygen. If there is no oxygen, this single glucose molecule without oxygen, it's like without money, can release only 2 ATP molecules. So what happens? Anaerobic respiration will form, will occur, and the byproducts of respiration will be lactic acid, which is not wanted. Like the normal activities will suffer. This is the reason why we need oxygen at the tissue level. Now, what is oxygen therapy? A normal person breathing atmospheric air is receiving oxygen at normal levels, and the body has its own reserves to provide oxygen more than what is required at the tissue level. Once all these reserves are used up, then we need to supplement oxygen to maintain the normal activity. That is when the patient becomes hypoxic, when all the reserves are used up, that is the time we have to provide oxygen. Oxygen therapy is provision of supplemental oxygen to maintain the normal activities of the body. Now, when to give? We'll come into the details of when to provide oxygen. Like when the patient becomes hypoxic, definitely we'll have to give, and we will come into the details of this matter. Now, the question is, who should start oxygen? On the bedside, the person who sees somebody is getting hypoxic should start the oxygen immediately. But make sure a medical officer titrates oxygen according to the requirement of the patient as soon as possible. And this should be documented by the medical officer. Now, there are so many factors that we'll speak about the adequacy of patient oxygenation. Now, adequate partial pressure of oxygen in blood should be more than 60 millimeters of mercury. Adequate hemoglobin concentration should be 7 gram per liter. And in a cardiac patient, it should be more than 8 gram per liter. There should be adequate blood flow to the tissues. Oxygen therapy aims at increasing the partial pressure of oxygen in blood as well as the saturation of hemoglobin. We'll come into the details. Now, speaking about oxygen therapy, there are a lot of simple things we are doing every day, but unknowingly we are doing so many things. If we know what we are doing, like we can work in a better way. As I said, oxygen can be a lifesaver, but at times it can be a poison also. Like oxygen is a free radical, and as a free radical can be a poison if given in unwanted doses for a long duration of time. Why is it a poison? The superoxide radical oxygen, if given for prolonged periods, can cause ciliary dysfunction. It can cause harmful effects to the lung, and it can cause harmful effects to the brain also. High flow oxygen or high concentrations of oxygen given for prolonged periods of time can cause absorption atelectasis or oxidative damage to the pneumocytes. The pneumocytes should function normally to maintain the normal patency of the alveoli. And normally, when we people breathe, after one breath, the second breath is triggered by an increase in carbon dioxide. Partial pressure of carbon dioxide, when it goes up, the chemoreceptors in the brainstem will sense that carbon dioxide is going up. It's time to breathe. So that is how the next breath is triggered by the brain in a normal person. But mind you, when you have a COPD patient in front of you, just understand, for them, they have the carbon dioxide levels elevated all the time. So the chemoreceptors in the brain will not be sensitive to any slight elevation in carbon dioxide, and it will not trigger the next breath. For them, hypoxia might be the next trigger. So if a COPD patient comes to you and you start oxygen in high doses at night when the patient has 89% or 90% saturation, of course the patient is going to deteriorate. So you have to provide oxygen in select situations, in select patients, in select doses. Also, I want to suggest one thing, like when you transfer patient from one point to another with oxygen on, make sure that you ensure uninterrupted oxygen supply so that there will not be any fluctuations in the oxygen levels. I want to familiarize you to some terminologies we commonly use in oxygen therapy. One is fraction of inspired oxygen. To the admin, can you please unmute for some time?
Okay, ma'am. I will do that. Ma'am, now participants are unmuted.
Okay, just a question which I had mentioned a while ago. What will be the fraction of inspired oxygen what we are breathing? Can somebody answer this question? This is a straightforward, simple question.
21%. Between 20% and 21%. Yes.
Yes. So this I showed in a slide before. So the rest is contributed by what? Like you said, it is 21%. What happened? What is the other percentage? Like 79% is contributed by what?
Nitrogen.
nitrogen, and there is a small percentage of other gas mixtures.
0.3% of carbon dioxide.
Yes.
0.3%.
So, fraction of inspired oxygen is 21%. So, it's clear to everybody. We are breathing room air. We are taking in 21% of inspired oxygen. Now, the next question is, what is partial pressure of oxygen? We are speaking about partial pressure of oxygen from the atmospheric air to the tissue level till now. What is partial pressure of oxygen in arterial blood? Partial pressure of oxygen is this small a in PaO2 represents partial pressure of oxygen in arterial blood. If you write capital A for this PaO2, it will represent partial pressure of oxygen in alveoli. That is alveoli oxygen partial pressure. Now we are speaking about arterial side partial pressure. What is it? Can somebody answer this? Hello?
95%.
No, I'm not asking the percentage. I'm just asking, what is this? What is this partial pressure of oxygen in arterial blood?
90 to 105 millimeter of mercury.
No, that's not what I mentioned. Like, this is the pressure of oxygen. If oxygen is occupying the whole gases, like if the whole amount of gases in the blood are taken, and oxygen is the percentage occupying that part, this will be the pressure, like partial pressure of oxygen. Now, I'm going to ask the next question, that is saturation of oxygen, SaO2. What does that mean? SaO2. See, PaO2 and SaO2 are two things we usually see in the NABG report, PaO2 and SaO2. SaO2, can somebody say what is SaO2? Saturation, I have written there like percentage of hemoglobin saturated with oxygen. Okay, I will come to this later. So this is one term we have to familiarize. And what is SpO2? Can somebody say what is SpO2? Okay, I'll tell you something. Fraction of inspired oxygen is something that we inspire or we give to the patient. Now, to assess the adequacy of our oxygen supplementation, we look into the ABG, we see two factors, like one is PaO2 and SaO2. And when we don't have an ABG, when we provide a particular FiO2, we will assess by a non-invasive method on the screen or through a small instrument, the pulse oximeter, and what we see on the screen will be SpO2, which is a non-invasive measure of SaO2. So commonly you people might be coming across SpO2, and you know what FiO2 you are providing. PaO2 and SaO2 you can see only when you are doing an ABG. Now we'll come into the details of what is saturation of oxygen in blood. Now we will go into the aorta. We are considering aorta, and we are considering 100 ml of aorta, 100 ml of blood in aorta. Just everybody picturize this, 100 ml of blood in the aorta. And here we have the, in the blood, we have the RBC going, and inside the RBC, there is hemoglobin. I have shown an RBC here. In the hemoglobin, there is a hemolecule. Hemolecule and the globin molecules are there. Consider one hemoglobin molecule. And in the heme, you can see four different sites. And four different sites have ferrous ions. And these are ready to receive oxygen molecules. And these four different sites, they can receive one oxygen molecule each. So once they are filled up, when they are 100% filled up, the four oxygen sites will be filled up. And we consider that this hemoglobin molecule is 100% saturated. And I think you understand the point. Like when you say a hemoglobin is 100% saturated, that means all the four sites are filled with oxygen molecules. If I say only three sites are filled up, that means this hemoglobin molecule is 75% filled. And if I say this hemoglobin molecule have only two oxygen molecules added to it, that means this is 50% filled. And if there is only one site filled up, that is 25% filled. So that is the saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen. Now, let me ask you something. There is a question now. We are carrying a hemoglobin molecule which is 100% saturated to the tissue level. So what percentage of hemoglobin or what percentage of oxygen will be released at the tissue level? Or what will be the saturation of oxygen when it leaves the tissue? Like, we are going through the arterial side, we are traveling with this particular molecule which is 100% saturated. We pass through the capillary. Till then we are 100% saturated. At the tissue level, we release oxygen. This was our idea. The whole idea of circulation, blood circulation, is to provide oxygen at the tissue level. And we are going with this idea. We reached the tissue. Now we delivered some oxygen there. Now we want to know what is the saturation of hemoglobin after this oxygen delivery. How many molecules are of oxygen are delivered there at the tissue level? Anybody can
four
volunteer?
Molecules.
Four.
Can somebody come up with an answer?
Four molecules.
Four molecules, if you release there, you come back with 0% saturation. Have you seen a venous side VBG, venous side blood gas analysis?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen saturation 0% there? So that is not right. Can somebody else volunteer another answer?
70.
At some point, there are only four answers that is possible because the total is 100%. Yeah. And somebody has already given, it is not 100% after releasing oxygen on the venous side. It's not 0% either. Now it's only left with two answers. Can somebody volunteer?
60 to 70.
Sorry?
60 to 70%.
I am asking specifically with these four molecules. One person said four molecules will be released and you reach a saturation of 0%. If I go there with 100% and if I don't release anything, then probably I will come back with 100% saturation. I'm speaking about a single hemoglobin molecule. What you said is right. If you take an average, I'm speaking about a single hemoglobin molecule now. But if you're considering an average or if you are considering a VBG, what you said is right. I'm just trying to make your concept clear. Or else I am indirectly asking you how many oxygen molecules will be released from a hemoglobin at the tissue level in a normal situation. You said this hemoglobin molecule is going to carry four molecules and it's 100% saturated and it is reaching the tissue level and it's going to release oxygen there.
Only three molecules.
Sorry?
Three molecules.
Three molecules will be released there? Is it that you meant? So you say that when you come to the venous side, it will be the saturation will be 25%?
Sorry, one molecule.
One molecule will be released. You are very right. See, one molecule will be released at the tissue level. And now you are coming back with 75% saturation on the venous side.
Yeah.
So if you see ABG and if you see the saturation is less than 75% or 75%, you can first think it's probably a venous sample.
Yes.
Until and unless the screen shows a saturation of 50 or 50 SpO2 or so, this will be just because this is a venous sample rather than an arterial sample. You said it's very right. What you said is very right. Now, if you consider an average of blood, 100 ml, we are speaking about 100 ml, 100 ml blood, in the aortic side, in the aorta, we are speaking about 100 ml. So we come with 100% saturation. We release one molecule each, 25% is released. And on the venous side, the saturation comes down to 75%. But if you take an average at times, it will be between less than 75. Or if you find any value between 75 to 90 or so, we can consider it as maybe a venous admixture. Somebody has gone through a vein, collected a sample from the artery or came back from the artery, passed again through the vein, collected a little sample from the vein also, and you got a result and it might be a venous admixture. If you get a saturation in the ABG or in the blood gas sample you said sent between 75 to 90. Now, coming back to something else, which is very important. Now, the question is, we are on the arterial side in the aorta and we are considering 100 ml of blood on the aorta, which is enriched with oxygen. Now, I am asking this question to you, like which all forms is oxygen carried in blood? Can somebody tell me?
Bound to hemoglobin.
Sorry?
Bound to hemoglobin.
Yes.
And plasma dissolved in plasma.
Okay, there are two different forms. And which is the major form?
Bound form
or the dissolved form?
The bound form.
It's a pure physiology you have learned for long years.
Bound form.
So what percentage do you think it will be the bound form? Oxygen is carried in the bound form?
97%.
More than that. We'll come to it. Now, arterial oxygen on the arterial side, oxygen in the bound form, there is a formula. Be clear with this formula. Like 1 gram of hemoglobin, when fully saturated with 100% oxygen, will carry 1.34 ml of oxygen. Can somebody repeat this? 1 gram of hemoglobin, when fully saturated, 4 molecules of oxygen, fully saturated, 100% saturated, will carry 1.34 ml of oxygen. Clear? Am I clear?
Yes, madam.
Okay, so can you tell me, like, if this patient has 15 grams of hemoglobin and a saturation of 100% and they are carrying 1.34 ml with each hemoglobin, what will be the total oxygen content? 15 grams hemoglobin, saturation is 100%, and each molecule will carry 1.34 ml of oxygen. This is what I have given in the formula.
20 ml.
Okay. We'll come back to it again and come to the dissolved form. The dissolved form depends upon the partial pressure of oxygen. And the dissolved form, I have given the formula. It is something like PaO2 into 0.003. How much will it come? If it is 100% partial pressure of oxygen, how much will it be?
0.3.
So you take it as 0.3 ml. And we are considering 100 ml of blood. You can write it down somewhere. Like 100 ml of blood, you said 20.1 ml it will come, like if it is 15 grams of hemoglobin in the bound form and 0.3 ml of blood in the dissolved form. How much it will be in 100 ml? How much will 100 ml carry? Add both together, 20.1 plus 0.3, it will come to 20.4 ml. So imagine the volume of oxygen carried by 100 ml of blood on the arterial side is 20.1 ml. Clear?
Yes.
Now we come to another calculation. See, we calculated for 100 ml is 20.4 ml of oxygen. Consider 1 liter, 10 times, it will be approximately 200 ml. 1 liter of blood on the arterial side will carry 200 ml of oxygen. And if you consider one cardiac output, which is around 5 liters of oxygen, it will carry 1 liter of 5 liter of blood, like arterial blood, during a cardiac cycle, during 1 minute cardiac output will carry approximately 1 liter of oxygen. So this is what is being carried every minute to the tissue level. 1 liter of oxygen carried, like we are supposing that the cardiac output is 5 liter, it is carrying around 1 liter of oxygen to the tissues every minute. Now, what is actually required at the tissue level? How much oxygen is required by a person for normal metabolism at the tissue level per minute? Can somebody tell? You can guess. So we are carrying like 1 liter of oxygen to the tissue level. What is actually needed at the tissue level? What was the requirement?
20.
No. You can multiply by 10.
200.
Yes. 200 ml of oxygen is required by the tissues altogether. The whole body requires 200 ml of oxygen at the tissue level for internal respiration. but we are providing 1 liter, which is 5 times of what is required. So 200 ml it will utilize, 400 ml is not, 800 ml is reserve what we are carrying with us. It is just a reserve. So if somebody manifests hypoxia, it is after utilizing the reserve also. Like there will be a compensation in the body where the body will try to compensate for a decrease in hemoglobin at the tissue level by using up this reserve. This 400 ml reserve is also used up, and then body cannot compensate. Obviously, the patient is going to manifest hypoxia. Now the question is, what will be your PaO2 breathing room air?
95 to 100.
Does it vary from one person to another?
No.
Does it vary with a younger age to older age to middle age? Does it vary with age?
It can vary with age.
It will vary with age. There is a simple formula for your calculation, simple calculation, rule of thumb. PaO2 can be calculated, like not calculated. You can think that the PaO2 will be something with something 120 minus age divided by 2, half of the age, 120 minus half of the age. Like you can calculate for an 80 year old, what will be the PaO2?
Eighty years.
120 minus half of the age.
Eighty.
Very good. If somebody of your age, say you are 22, what will be the PaO2? Okay, now you are clear about it. This is a rough calculation. Now, when will you say that the patient is hypoxemic? Or when will you say the patient is having hypoxemia?
PaO2 less than 60.
Definitely 60, less than 60 is hypoxemia. But like we will act at this point for sure when the PaO2 comes less than 60. That is our action point. What you said is very right. But when you say the patient is having hypoxemia, the value is slightly more than that. 60 is the action point. You can watch till PaO2 is 60. But you can, the starting of hypoxia, you can increase your number.
80.
Yes. So I'll give you this slide now. See, PaO2, as the partial pressure of oxygen increases, SaO2 will also increase. So the normal person with PaO2 80 to 100, the SaO2 will be more than 95. I am sure you will all know the oxygen dissociation curve. Like somewhere till 60 partial pressure of oxygen, the saturation will stay almost stable. And once the partial pressure of oxygen reaches 60. That is the point where the patient moves from the mild hypoxemic stage to the moderate hypoxemic stage. Suddenly the ODC will show a steep downslope. That is where the oxygen desaturation will happen suddenly. Now, that's why I put the ODC curve on the right side. Now, mild hypoxemia will be somewhere between 60 to 79. And the saturation on the screen will be still 90 to 94. In some cases, you don't need to act even, not even to supplement oxygen. But if it goes down below 60, that is the point, you have to know this point. This is the point where the saturation on the screen will show something like 88 or 89. If you come across this point, you have to act at this point. You have to supplement oxygen. But for a COPD patient, things are slightly different. But for a normal person, if you reach this point of 60 and a saturation of 88, you have to be very careful. Patient, if at all desaturates, the desaturation might be faster. Like you see in the ODC curve, the desaturation will be quick. So moderate hypoxemia will start from 40 to 59 and saturation will be something like 75 to 89. Severe hypoxemia will be less than 40. And at this stage, the saturation will be less than 75%. And the severe hypoxemia stage will be something similar to the venous sample in a normal person. Less than 40 PaO2 and less than 75 saturation will be the normal thing on the venous head. That is what we are going to get in a severe hypoxemia if you are taking an arterial sample. Now, special consideration to select populations, like when you provide oxygen therapy to COPD patients, the oxygen therapy goals will not be to achieve something more than 94%. Your goals will be to achieve a SpO2 or something like 80 to 90%, which very much because I said like you should not reduce their hypoxic drive. And the PaO2 target will be something like 60 to 70%. So this will minimize oxygen-induced hypoventilation, hypercarbia, and worsening of already what has happened, like carbon dioxide-induced narcosis might not worsen. So you have to be careful when you are supplementing. You provide the minimum amount of oxygen required to achieve something like 88 to 90% SpO2 and a PaO2 of something like 60 to 70%. Now, I'll try to familiarize you with the oxygen supply sources in hospital settings. I don't know what supply you have in your hospital, but the common oxygen supply systems in the hospitals are the central supply systems through wall outlets, and the central supplies usually comes from manifold systems. Cylinder manifold is a common system. Some places they stock oxygen in the liquid form, and there are places where oxygen is prepared with oxygen concentrators. I think most of the centers in hospitals will be using liquid oxygen from the central supply or cylinder manifolds. Now, let's come to a oxygen cylinder manifold. Can somebody say what you have in your hospital? What is the oxygen source in your hospital?
Cylinder.
Cylinder. Have you gone to the manifold room?
No.
How they store this oxygen in the cylinder cylinder form is there will be a primary storage group and a secondary storage group. There can be variable number of cylinders. Some places they stock two on each side, the primary supply and the secondary supply. These are usually connected. Like once the primary supply is finished, it will switch to the secondary supply. Each part, like the primary supply as well as the secondary supply, can be any number of cylinders between 2 to 20. But like in your hospital, you should ensure that you should be able to have a backup of oxygen for at least 5 days, either in the liquid form or in the oxygen manifold, whatever. The oxygen should last for at least 5 days. Now, coming to the oxygen supply through cylinder, I'm speaking about individual cylinders. Like you come across these cylinders, like when you are giving oxygen to the patient, if you don't have a wall outlet, usually it comes with a cylinder. There is a tank. It is usually held in a trolley or a cart, and you can see a pressure regulator. Usually the cylinder has oxygen stored in high pressures. This pressure will not be tolerated by the patient. So there is a pressure reducing valve at the outlet, and it reduces the oxygen pressure to what the patient can tolerate, usually to 25 PSI. And there is a pressure gauge indicating what is the final pressure of the oxygen delivered to the patient. And this is connected usually to a flow meter. And I hope you are all familiar with the flow meter. The flow meter has a rotating knob. You can see the pressure gauge. There is a screw cap connected to the cylinder. The pressure reducing valve is there. There is a humidifier bottle, and the oxygen is delivered to the patient. This will be, I am sure you all are very familiar with this. Now, I want to familiarize you to something else. So as you can see, what is the cylinder we are seeing here? Like all the cylinders come with different colors, and these cylinders are usually color coded. Oxygen cylinders usually come with a black color with a white shoulder, and it comes in different sizes. And you can somebody read the sizes available? Hello? Hello to
B, please. D, E, F, G,
H and M.
Yeah.
These are the sizes of oxygen cylinders available, but it is not available everywhere. The common cylinder what we use, what you people use, can you just tell me? The common cylinder, you don't have to familiarize with all of these. What is the common type of cylinder you are using? Is it a big one or a small one?
D type.
E is the common one. E is the common cylinder you use, and probably the bigger jumbo cylinder you might be using is M. So you have to familiarize with these two things. Like we will see other headings like what I have given here. Now we come across the second part. Like I will go into detail of each. We have to see and familiarize with the E-type and M-type cylinders, which we commonly come across. Now the second thing other than the size is the capacity. So just read like for B cylinder, it is only 200 liters. And for E cylinder, how much is the capacity?
660 liters.
660 liters of oxygen is carried in a full cylinder when full. That is the maximum it can hold, 660 liters. Like make a clear idea of this. And if it is the M cylinder, how much it will be? A full cylinder, new, fully filled and come to us, will carry how many liters?
3,450 liters.
Okay, like make a note of these two numbers, like 660 liters for a E cylinder. This is a small cylinder you are commonly using. And if there is a standalone cylinder, a jumbo cylinder you are coming across, that will carry 3,450 liters when it is full. Now we come across another thing. What is the next? It is shown pressure in PSI. There are different units to show the pressure of oxygen in the cylinder, but we usually come across this unit, PSI. So like for the E cylinder, what is the PSI? For a full cylinder, what is the PSI? Okay. There is a pressure gauge associated with the cylinder. Always there will be a pressure gauge connected to the cylinder. If you have not come across it, or if you have not paid attention to it, just see it next time you come across a cylinder. There will be a pressure gauge and you will see this value PSI. And when you have a full cylinder with 660 liters in an E cylinder, will show a pressure of 1,900. Make a note of this also. And now if it is an M cylinder, you will see a pressure of 2,200. Now, I will tell you why I'm stressing too much on this cylinder thing. Do you people take patients for some transfers from one room to another, one investigation, or take the patient from one hospital to another? Do you accompany them? Do you accompany any patient for patient transfers? Anybody?
Yes,
in the ambulance from one area to another area in your hospital, do you accompany the patient? No, nobody goes with the patient? Okay, I'll tell you something. Like the tear weight shown in this is the empty cylinder weight, and the other is the valve type. There are two different types, bullnose type and pin index type. That is okay. Don't need to put too much attention to this. Now, these are the pressure gauges what I am speaking about. Can you see this slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yeah,
here you can see the pressures written, like on the right side you can see 500, 1000, 1500, 2000. And at 2000 they are marked it as full, like something like 1900 we have considered as full in a E cylinder. Here in the pressure gauge they have said 2000 is full. Now you open the cylinder and see what the pressure gauge shows. And the needle, what it indicates will tell you how much the cylinder is filled. like if you know it is full, it is only having 660 liters. If it is half full, how many will be there? How many liters will be there?
330 liters.
And you are accompanying the patient for a patient transfer. And you have put the flow rate in the flow meter, 15 liters. Or I say, for an easy calculation, I'll say you have put 10 liters. Now you have 330 liters, like 1,000 is, 2,000 will hold 660 liters. 1,000 PSI will hold something like 330 liters. Now you have set a flow rate of 10 liters. How long do you expect the cylinder to last? Ten liters per minute. 330 liters only you have in hand. Or I'll tell you something, you have 330 rupees in your pocket and you are spending every minute 10 rupees. How many minutes will you be able to spend in the same rate?
33
minutes only. It will last for only half an hour.
Yeah.
If you are sure that when you are accompanying the patient, you are going to go in and come or you shift from one room to another, you will take less than 30 minutes. You will not waste your time in the lift. If you are very sure, it's okay. Like if you expect a long transfer, like which will take longer time, make sure that cylinder is full. Or else, like if you are putting on a high flow rate, if the patient is on 2 liter, of course this 330 liter cylinder will help you to be with the patient for say 150 minutes. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay. Ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, clear, clear.
So they officially they have given a formula for calculation of how much will be the cylinder lasting for. There is a calculation. They have given something like a conversion factor. This is a simple calculation, what I said, but they have given a simple calculation also. Like they have given a question like say a E cylinder with 1500 PSI and you are giving 2 liters per minute, how long it will last? So they say you have to consider a conversion factor of 0.28 also. So you have to put 1,500 into 0.28 and then divide by 2. I think for simple calculation, you go by simple and plain thinking. Like depending upon the pressure, you calculate the amount of possible oxygen in the cylinder and you divide it by the flow rate. Then you will know how long it will last. And you have to arrange cylinder accordingly. Like you should, at times you should be able to take an extra cylinder with you. Otherwise you will land up in problem. Now see, halfway through your travel, if you find that you don't have oxygen lasting for the rest of the time, then you will be in soup. So make sure that you don't land up in some problems. Now, what all are the methods like you will provide oxygen to the patient? Like oxygen is in the cylinder and you have to provide this oxygen to the patient. There are some devices like low flow devices and high flow delivery devices. Like if the patient patient is relatively stable, just require low quantity of oxygen and is not in distress, you can go with low flow oxygen delivery devices. If the patient is in distress requiring high flow rates, then you will have to go for high flow oxygen delivery devices. The low flow delivery devices, I am sure all of you are very familiar. You have come across nasal cannula, simple Hudson face mask, Venturi mask, partial rebreathing mask, all this you are very familiar. Now we'll come to this. The low flow oxygen devices which you usually use are patient dependent devices. Like they are variable performance devices. Why? Because you provide, like I want to tell you, I'll come across it. This variable, like if the patient breathes more, it will, like you will provide 2 liters of oxygen. If the patient breathes more, the patient is breathing at the rate of 15 liters per minute and you are providing only 2 liters. So in addition to 2 liters, patient will get 13 liters of air from the atmosphere when they are breathing heavily. So they are patient performance dependent, variable FiO2 will be provided. So these can be still used in patients when the minute volumes of the patient is less than 8 to 10 liters and the respiratory rate if it is low, like less than 10 liters. Say for relatively stable patients, you can go with low flow oxygen devices. Inspiratory flow requirement for them, if it is less than 30 liters. We cannot measure this inspiratory flow requirement for a patient just lying down, but you can see whether the patient is in distress or in air hunger, that you can watch and see. High flow performance devices like Venturi mask or HFNC, high flow nasal oxygen cannulas, can be used in patients with severe hypoxia requiring high FiO2 and with a high inspiratory flow requirement or with high air hunger requiring more than 40 liters per minute. Now, this is the most common thing you are using. As I told you, like fraction of inspired air is 21%. When you supplement 1 liter of oxygen through a nasal cannula, how much FiO2 are you increasing? Can anybody volunteer? You are providing 1 liter of oxygen through a nasal cannula. And you are trying to increase the...
Sorry? Each 1 liter, around 4%. Each one yes. liter, around
each
4%.
Each 1 liter, 4%. Yeah. So approximately, say, room air, you are breathing 20%, that you find that all the resources are used up, patient is in distress. You give 1 liter. And now... now you provide...
Ma'am, that slide has changed. Excuse me, ma'am.
Coming back.
Okay.
Coming back to the slide. So you are providing 1 liter, you are increasing the FiO2 fraction of inspired oxygen by 4%. You give 2 liters of oxygen, how much will be the FiO2?
It's 28%.
Similarly, with the nasal cannula, the maximum amount of the flow, like oxygen flow you can provide is something like 6 liters. And you can achieve an FiO2 of up to 44%. But the only problem, like by the time you reach 6 liter, patient will not be very comfortable. High jet of oxygen into the nose, patient will not be very comfortable. So up to 4 liters or 5 liters, it's okay to give with the nasal cannula. If you are reaching up to 6 liters, it is preferable to go to the simple Hudson mask. This also you are familiar?
Yes, ma'am.
Routinely you will be using, I know that. Now, yeah, the once you use a Hudson mask, make sure you pull the straps well. So that oxygen will not leak by the side. You imagine you are giving an FiO2 of 0.4, and if oxygen is leaking by the side, of course, you are not providing it. Now, with oxygen flow rate like up to 7 to 8, if you provide, you will achieve a maximum of FiO2 0.6. More if you give, you are not going to provide more FiO2. So whatever is extra is a waste. So imagine you have a Hudson mask, you increase the oxygen to 15 liters, anything more than 10, it's not going to change anything with the Hudson mask, or you change your interface. So with 7 to 8 liters, you're going to achieve 0.6 FiO2 with a Hudson mask. Now, there is something more you can add to the mask. If you have a reservoir bag, a simple reservoir bag, which takes in oxygen, you can provide an FiO2 up to 0.8. For a stable patient breathing comfortably, you can still provide oxygen up to, with an FiO2 up to 0.8. Now, for patients with air hunger and requiring high FiO2, and if you want to ensure that they are provided with a fixed FiO2, for these, all these devices, what we mentioned before, are all depending upon the patient's performance. As patient breathes more air will be entrained and FiO2 will be low. If you are providing, say, 5 liters of oxygen and patient's inspiratory flow is something like 15 liters, the rest of the 10 liters will be environmental air, room air. So FiO2 will come down. Like whatever you expect out of this, if the flow rate is, the patient's inspiratory flow rate is very high, the FiO2 will be low. But if the patient's respiratory rate is stable and patient is comfortable, low respiratory rate, and if you provide, say, 5 liters of oxygen and the patient's inspiratory flow is something like 15 liters, of course, the FiO2 will be high. That means these devices, even if you provide oxygen, it is patient dependent. The FiO2 will vary. The more the patient breathes, the FiO2 will be lower. The less the patient breathes, more oxygen what we deliver will go into the lungs and the FiO2 delivered will be high. But if you want to give fixed FiO2 device, if you fixed FiO2 through a device, you have to think about Venturi mask or eye flow nasal oxygen. And there are intermediate devices like non-invasive ventilation with non-invasive ventilation machines, BiPAP, HFNC. There are so many other devices. We go to the next level. Now, the simple device which we come across is a Venturi mask, like especially when you have a COPD patient with you, you'll try to reduce FiO2 and you make sure a particular FiO2 is delivered. Venturi mask work on the principle that there is a tube through which oxygen comes in. And the tube is narrowed at one point. And once the tube is narrowed, the jet of oxygen which comes in, suddenly the jet becomes stronger. And once the jet becomes stronger, and if there is a hole by the side, the jet will create a suction effect at the nozzle. The narrowed end will have a suction effect. And if you have an opening at the side, it will entrain air from outside. So what happens, like after the narrowing, there is a suction forming inside, which will pull in air from outside. And there is a mixing of gas inside the tube. And what is carried forward is a mixture of oxygen coming through the tube as well as the air entrained from the atmosphere. So the size of the narrowing is fixed. The entrainment gaps in the Venturi is also fixed. So that will assure a fixed amount of oxygen or fraction of inspired oxygen is fixed, whatever the patient takes, even if the patient suffered change. This is the principle. This is called Bernoulli's principle. And Venturi mask comes in different colors. This is actually color-coded. And the different colors, like we have to ensure that for each color coding, to provide a particular FiO2, we have to provide the oxygen in the specified quantity, like say for a blue to provide 24%, even if it is returned 24%, to provide this 24% oxygen, you have to provide 2 liters per minute. And this is all fixed, like for this flow through the nozzle and the size of the entrainment port. That is, you can see some openings on the sides. Like these openings are the entrainment ports through which atmospheric air is pulled in. And this entrainment port size is also fixed. See, as you come to higher sizes, like for 60%, the entrainment port size is smaller because less air will be entrained. Like as more air is entrained in the lower sizes, the FiO2 is low. When the entrainment port size is smaller, as we reach the higher percentage of FiO2, the size of the entrainment ports are small. Only little air is entrained. So whatever we provide, the oxygen goes in more rather than the entrained air. So like with these devices, what we can provide maximum is 60% or 0.6 FiO2, provided we give 15 liters of oxygen with the green Venturi. Now there are non-rebreathing masks or partial rebreathing masks. Like in partial rebreathing mask with a reservoir, what happens is there is an oxygen port connected to the reservoir bag. The oxygen keeps filling. And when the patient exhales, the initial part of exhalation also fills into the reservoir bag. The initial part of exhalation is from the dead space. And this is full of oxygen. So this part will go into the bag and patient during the next breath will take up oxygen from the reservoir bag. And that can, this partial rebreathing mask can provide an FiO2 up to 0.8. And there are non-rebreathing masks where exhaled air will not reach into the reservoir bag. In those with 15 liters of oxygen per minute, we can achieve an FiO2 up to 100%. There are bag valve devices like the Ambu bag, which can also provide an FiO2 90 to 100%, but this is a temporary measure. This cannot be used as a source of continuous oxygen supply, but can be used as an interface before intubation or so. Now, the second equipment what we use as an interface in a patient requiring high inspiratory flow requiring high flow of oxygen is HFNO cannula. It's also called Thrive or mini CPAP. this interface when you put it into the nose with high flows. Like why we call it Thrive is it is placed transnasally. It has a humidification and it is a rapid inflammation ventilatory exchange because we give very high flows like up to 60 liters per minute instead of 15 liters we achieve through the Venturi thing. We are providing 60 liters per minute to 70 liters per minute through this nasal cannula. This usually provides PEEP. With the patient having a mouth closed, it will provide a PEEP of up to 7 millimeters of mercury. If the patient opens his mouth or so during eating or drinking something, the PEEP will still there at least at the rate of 3 millimeters of mercury. It can provide a constant FiO2, provides good humidification. I'll come to this point why humidification is important. And high flow rates like 50 to 100 liters exceeds patient's employee. It can be provided through this. This HFNC will be elaborated in a later class, not today. As I said, this what happens when we are giving HFNC is this also called Thrive. It is provided transnasally. We provide a humidified air inside and it's rapidly insufflated because we are giving at high flows. And rapid ventilatory exchange occurs because high flows are going in. Carbon dioxide is completely washed out. So ventilatory exchange of gases also happens well. It's tolerated by patient very well. And we use it in hypoxemic respiratory failure, very good in acute exacerbation of COPDs, temporary measures in pre-intubation and post-intubation, post-extubation phases for sleep apnea patients. In DNR patients, it can be used. Contraindications are actually contagious pulmonary infections, intracranial hypertension, children below 16 years, or if there is a partial airway obstruction. In COVID situations, like in patients who really don't need intubation, invasive ventilation, you can also use HFNO, even if we consider it as a contagious disease. This is practically very useful. HFNO and non-invasive ventilation is found to be very useful in COVID pneumonias. Now coming across something which you might not be very familiar with, this is the humidification. Whenever you are providing oxygen, there is something we are doing. Like normally our airway, upper airway is doing a major role like providing heat and humidification, adding heat and water to the air we are breathing. This is usually happens in the upper airway up to the level of trachea and the initial bronchi. Now, whenever we are interfering with this passage, the air which we push in will be sometimes dry air and the air will be going in large quantities and the normal natural mechanism of heating and humidification does not occur in this case. So when we are supplementing oxygen, we have to go with artificial methods to provide heat and humidification, at least with methods to prevent heat loss and prevent water loss. What happens if we do give dry air for a long time? Our cilia in the upper airway and the lower airway and in the alveoli, which is doing a primary function of clearing of secretions, it will not function well. And the crusts or the dry crusts will form and it's a source of infection. Usually in the upper airway up to the level of trachea, the temperature is usually of the inspired air is usually 22 degree centigrade and the relative humidity because water vapor is added to it, humidity is around 40%. At the level of trachea, it becomes heated more and the temperature goes up to 32 degree centigrade and relative humidity will be still 40%. In the lungs, in the initial say third or fourth generation of bronchi, the temperature is increased to 37 degrees. It will reach the normal body temperature and the humidity is water vapor content will be something like 99%. So I mentioned in one of the slides before, like the partial pressure of oxygen, which we inspired from atmosphere was 160 millimeters of mercury and it dropped to 105 millimeters of mercury when it reached the alveoli. This is because of this water vapor content. Now, what are the mechanisms we can provide to provide, we can provide humidification to the inspired air? You're familiar with these devices, like the oxygen flow meter is having a humidifier bottle which has some water in, and the gas passes through it and carries some water vapor when it is going in. The second is an HME. This is a heat moisture exchanger. It at least, even if it doesn't add any heat or moisture to the inspired air, it prevents loss of heat and moisture from the expired air. The other humidification systems are heated humidifier, where we have Fisher-Paykel humidifier systems, where we have water, and through the water, heated water, air passes and gets heated up and warm air goes in. This is a common in, this is very common in HFNC inbuilt. We have this humidification bottles, heat moisture exchanger, advanced humidifier systems, as I mentioned before. Now, we have to come across another factor, like we have provided oxygen to the patient. Now we have to assess, monitor whether whatever we are giving is adequate for the patient. Like we are giving 2 liters of oxygen, is it adequate for the patient? And we should be doing a constant monitoring when we are providing oxygen to the patient. As I said, any amount of a high concentration of oxygen for a long period is harmful rather than helpful. We have to titrate oxygen as the need says. Now, how do we clinically assess the patient? You can see the symptoms. You can look at the patient. If the patient is dyspneic, you look at three systems. Primarily, you have to look at three systems to ensure the adequacy of oxygen. You have to look at the CNS. You have to look at the lungs. You have to look at the heart. If the brain is okay, like if the patient doesn't have any confusion or disorientation, make sure this end organ part is okay. It is receiving oxygen and patient is well. There shouldn't be any confusion or disorientation. If heart is overworking, if the lung is not providing sufficient amount of oxygen, what heart will do, heart will overwork, it will pump more and heart will be at strain. Patient might present with palpitations, angina, and the lung patient can have dyspnea. And look at the vital signs of these three systems. And also the kidney also, when you're looking at the vital signs, as I said, for the lungs, again, you look for the tachypnea signs. If there is pallor or cyanosis, whether there is bradycardia or tachycardia, you can ensure that like heart is at strain, you have to increase oxygen. If there is oliguria, kidney is at strain, altered GCS. But whenever you see that the SpO2 probably is showing some oxygen levels low and you are providing oxygen, make sure you are supplying oxygen from the port in the planned way. There might be some leak in the oxygen flow meter and the connection where it joins the humidifier. You have to check whether the prescribed amount of oxygen is reaching the person. You have to make sure the mask or the nasal cannula is properly placed. This is very important before you make any change in the oxygen level, oxygen supply. Pulse oximetry, I'm sure everybody is familiar, and pulse oximeter is the bedside monitoring system. You can ensure that the patient is getting sufficient amount of oxygen. Now, when bigger centers where you have an arterial blood gas analysis, you can clearly look at some factors which will tell you whether the oxygen supply is adequate. As I mentioned before, you can do a simple ABG, and directly looking at the ABG, you will get two values, PaO2 and SaO2. That will tell you where you are, whether your oxygen therapy is adequate, or you are, if you are treating it over than what is required. If the PO2 is going up, like say 200, you are providing oxygen and the PO2 is something like 200, you have to bring down, you have to reduce oxygen. And there is something like PF ratio. I don't know whether you are familiar with it or not. You have to calculate the PaO2 against what FiO2 you are giving. That is called PaO2 by FiO2. This is very important. Like whenever you get an ABG report, you have to write in it. If it doesn't come in a print, you have to write at what settings did you do this ABG. It's all important what PaO2 is achieved at what FiO2 you are providing. Say if patient is getting 100% oxygen and the PaO2 is 80, you shouldn't be that happy because you are providing a very high dose of oxygen inside.
So if you have somebody who is getting an FiO2 of 40% and the PaO2 is showing something like 120, then you should assume that the lung is getting normal. So whenever you see an ABG, you have to look at the PF ratio also. So if PF ratio is anything more than 400 is normal. If it is less than 300, you will consider ARDS. Now there is something called alveolar arterial gradient. For this, there is a calculation for the alveolar oxygen and arterial oxygen you have in front of you, which is the PaO2. If the alveolar arterial gradient is more than 25, then it is significant. You have to supplement oxygen. And you can also calculate the oxygen content in the arterial blood. That is what is called CaCO2. Now you are familiar with how to calculate arterial oxygen content on the arterial side. This is actually the oxygen bound to hemoglobin and oxygen dissolved in plasma. From this equation only, I told you, like, you have to make sure that the hemoglobin levels are adequate, then only it will carry sufficient amount of oxygen. And you have to make sure the saturation is adequate, then only it will carry the required amount of oxygen. Now I'll give you the formula for alveolar arterial oxygen gradient. Like alveolar oxygen gradient, you can calculate with FiO2 into partial pressure of atmospheric oxygen minus partial pressure of water vapor minus PaCO2 by 0.8. I don't think you need to remember this. And just another rule of thumb is a normal alveolar arterial gradient is something like H by 4 plus 4. That's all for the day. I hope you understood something. Thank you.
Boils apparatus, which type of cylinder is used? Boils means the
E type.
What
jumbo cylinder ആയിരിക്കും എനിക്ക് ശരിക്കും പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഇവിടുത്തെ ബാക്കിയുള്ള ഹോസ്പിറ്റൽസിലെ അറേഞ്ച്മെന്റ് എനിക്ക് അറിയില്ല. ജംബോ സിലിണ്ടേഴ്സ് പ്രോബബ്ലി നമ്മുടെ എം സിലിണ്ടേഴ്സ് പറഞ്ഞില്ലേ 3500.
അത് പക്ഷേ നമ്മൾ പ്ലാന്റിൽ വെക്കുന്നല്ലേ എം ടൈപ്പ് അല്ലെ എച്ച് ടൈപ്പ് ഒക്കെ.
Usually what we come, the small cylinders what we come across is the E cylinder. നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ചില സ്ഥലങ്ങളിൽ ഒരു വലിയൊരു വാർഡിലൊക്കെ വലിയ ജംബോ സിലിണ്ടേഴ്സ് വെക്കാറുണ്ട്. അതൊരു എം സിലിണ്ടർ ആണെന്നാണ് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കിയിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഐ എം നോട്ട് വെരി ഷുവർ വിച്ച് സിലിണ്ടർ ഇറ്റ് ഈസ്.
നമ്മൾ എച്ച് ആണെന്നാ കേട്ടിട്ടുള്ളത്. അതുപോലെ ബോയിൽസിൽ വെക്കുന്നത് ഡി ടൈപ്പും വാർഡിൽ കൊണ്ട് നമ്മൾ ആംബുലേറ്ററി ആയിട്ട് യൂസ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്
കാരണം ഞാൻ ബോയിൽസ് മെഷീൻ യൂസ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് ഒരുപാട് നാളുകളായി. നമ്മള് ബോയിൽസ് മെഷീൻ അല്ല, ഇപ്പൊ മെഷീൻസ് അഡ്വാൻസ് മെഷീൻസ് ആവുന്നതുകൊണ്ട് ഔട്ട്ലെറ്റ് മറ്റേ സെൻട്രൽ സപ്ലൈ ആണ് യൂഷ്വലി ഉള്ളത്. ഈ സിലിണ്ടേഴ്സ് ആണ് എന്റെ ബാക്കപ്പ് ആയിട്ട് വെക്കാറുള്ളത്. പിന്നെ മറ്റ് സെന്റേഴ്സിൽ എന്താണ് യൂസ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്? ഐ എം നോട്ട് വെരി ഷുവർ. ഐ എം സോറി. ഏത് സിലിണ്ടർ ആണെങ്കിലും ഞാൻ ഈ പറഞ്ഞ ഒരു സ്ലൈഡ് ഉണ്ടല്ലോ, ഇപ്പൊ ഞാൻ ഡിസ്പ്ലേ ചെയ്തിരിക്കുന്ന ഈ സ്ലൈഡ്, ബി ഷുവർ അബൌട്ട് ഇറ്റ്. എത്ര കപ്പാസിറ്റി ആണുള്ളത്? 4900 എന്നുള്ളത്. ആൻഡ് യു വിൽ ബി ഷുവർ ലൈക്ക് ഹൗ ലോങ് ഇറ്റ് വിൽ ലാസ്റ്റ്. അത് മറ്റേ നിങ്ങളുടെ സപ്ലയറോട് ചോദിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ അറിയാൻ പറ്റും ഏത് സിലിണ്ടർ ആണ് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് തരുന്നത് എന്നുള്ളത്.